Hi, I'm Alex McCrickard, and this is the Fishing Report for the month of December in Virginia. In this month's report, we're on the beautiful James River upstream of Lynchburg here, and we're going to go on a float trip and try our hand at fishing for muskie, commonly referred to as the fish of 1,000 casts or even the fish of 10,000 casts. I've never fished for muskie before. This is brand new for me. I'm going to be approaching the day today with a fly rod. I've got some big flies I'm going to throw around. I'm going to be joined today on this float trip by John Kirk, DWR's Access Coordinator, who's going to have a conventional approach today. We're also going to be joined by Jason Hallacher, DWR Fisheries Biologist, who's going to give us an overview on population trends of the muskie fishery here on the James and other popular rivers in the state, in addition to muskie management techniques. Stay tuned to come on the water with us. We started our float trip bright and early. Even though John and I had never fished for muskie before, we knew that muskie fishing requires patience and persistence. Getting skunked happens more frequently than some muskie anglers like to admit. But the prospect of fooling one of these toothy beasts kept John and I focused on the hunt. We casted, casted, and casted some more. All right, middle of the afternoon, we've been casting, and casting, and doing some more casting. No fish in the boat, no fish moved, but that's kind of par for the course for muskie fishing. So we're gonna keep at it though. Throw in some big flies. John, what are you throwing? Some bigger baits?
Bigger crankbait there.
We're gonna try to rattle one up here in the latter part of the float. We're gonna stay determined. And you can cast that a heck of a lot further than the fly. a lot easier. It hasn't been a lack of effort today. How many casts do you think we've made, Jason?
9,999. One more. Go to the right over here.
All right, we'll try one on the right.
I caught mine on the fly right over here.
Oh, wow.
Taking a break to learn more about muskie fishing from one of our biologists seemed like an appropriate way to rest our casting arms.
So today we're actually lucky to be joined by Jason Hallacher, regional fisheries biologist here at the agency. And Jason, you've been with the agency for 17 years now and have been involved with muskie management and just working with muskie for a long, long time. What have you seen with the population trends on our muskie fisheries across the state over the years?
Yeah, we've done a lot of work with muskie, especially in like the last 20 years. But, you know, muskie were historically stocked starting back in like the 60s.
Yeah.
And they were stocked as a trophy fish, you know, something challenging to fish for anglers. Because in the western part of the state, we don't have some of those big, large, you know, impressive trophy fish at times. And so over the years, they were kind of considered more of a diversity fish. We didn't pay a lot of attention to them. It was kind of icing on the cake if anglers would catch one, but we never really had fisheries that people could actually target until we really started to focus on what type of habitat these like. So in the 90s, biologists looked at habitat on the New River, the James River, the Clinch, and the Shenandoah, and really tried to figure out where we can target stock these fish and where they can really thrive.
Yeah, get the most bang for your buck.
Exactly, and it worked really well. We were able to establish wild populations that are reproducing in the New River and the James River. We do see some reproduction in the Shenandoah, but the New and the James no longer need to be stocked because they are self-replicating. So that's really helpful. But we do continue to stock a lot of resources like certain reservoirs around the state.
Sure.
So we're able to continue to have that kind of diversity element in some of those other resources as well.
So today, Jason, we've been trying our hand at trying to catch muskie here on the upper James. As far as the James River fishery is concerned, what really makes the upper James a better fishery for muskie than, say, some of the sections of the middle James further downriver in the Piedmont?
Yeah. Well, first of all, we just have to acknowledge how gorgeous it is out here. I mean, the upper James is one of the most scenic rivers in Virginia.
Oh, yeah.
It's just amazing to float it. So regardless of how your fishing is, it's just awesome. But the habitat up here is just amazing, you mm-hmm. know, not only for muskie, but you really see a ton of pool habitat. These
yeah.
muskie like deep, slower moving pools. And with the upper James, you have a lot of riffle pool continuity down through the whole stretch. And so that's why these fish thrive so well up here. You also have good spawning habitat. You know, like I said before, we do see fish that spawn naturally up here.
Sure.
And muskie are cool water fish. You know, they need some cool water refuge in the summertime. Our summers do get pretty warm.
Yeah.
And so there's a lot of cool tributaries that come into the upper part of the James, some springs, and that allows them to kind of oversummer. Whereas in the middle James, you know, the habitat changes and it also gets pretty warm down there, as you're well aware.
Yeah, it gets a little warmer with water temperatures getting up near 90, which is definitely more stressful for them.
Exactly. But it's 100 miles of fishable water.
100 miles.
From Lick Run all the way to Lynchburg. I mean, ton of opportunities for anglers to contact muskie.
Yeah, you could fish all week and not float this. You could float different sections of the river every day.
Yeah, so, exactly.
Pretty unique. So I know you all typically complete your electrofishing sampling when we're looking at our muskie populations in the winter months, the colder months of the year. What have some of the electrofishing results shown from the past couple of years of sampling?
Yes, so we do sample in the winter, which is a little counterintuitive. A lot of our sampling takes place in the spring, summer, and fall, but
sure.
Muskie are still active in the winter months, and the colder temperatures do slow them down a little bit,
so yeah.
We are able to capture them. Just like muskie fishing, you know, with the rod and reel, electrofishing can be challenging to catch them, and it can be pretty exciting. And so we'll actually use multiple boats to kind of help corral and capture the fish. And then we work them up just like any other game fish. You know, we measure and weigh, and we can look at population trends over time to kind of track these populations. It continues to be a growing there's growing popularity with these fish.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of new anglers are trying it out, and so we need to kind of keep our finger on the pulse of these populations, because
sure.
That'll have an impact as well as other factors. Typically we're seeing fish that range in like the 35 to 45 inch range. That's kind of the standard fish for the new James and the Shenandoah, but
it's a good average fish.
It really is. They grow fast and they grow nice and fat, and you will see a few of those elusive 50 inch muskie.
Yeah.
But honestly,
the exception, not the norm.
Yeah, I've only held like four in my life, you know, in my hand. So even for us, it's really rare to catch that true, you know, trophy 50-inch mark.
Unicorns do exist.
They do exist.
So we know that muskie are an apex predator. Here on the Upper James and some of our other systems, like the New and the Shenandoah, what are the muskie primarily foraging on throughout the year?
Well, our agency has done a ton of research on this subject because it's, you know, of interest to a lot of anglers.
Sure.
And we've done two separate studies with universities looking at the diet of these fish. And it's really fascinating because it can change over time.
Yeah.
They're an opportunistic feeder.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, they take advantage of what they can catch. But for the most part, they don't like spiny rayed fish.
Yeah.
And in the spring, they're spawning in March and April, and they're really shut off from feeding. They're just focusing on spawning. But when they get past the spawning time frame, they really start to put the feed bag on, and they'll feed primarily on smaller forage fish. They see a lot of minnows. Some of the larger ones like chubs and fall fish, of course, are always there. But they really take advantage of those minnow species. And then sometimes they'll grab a sunfish every now and then.
Mm-hmm.
Summertime's stressful for them. They're a cool water fish, like I mentioned before. And they do feed, but they're really trying to just weather the storm with those summer temperatures. So they kind of turn off a little bit. And in the fall, they need to get ready for winter, right? So in the fall and in the winter months, they're really feeding on larger prey items like suckers.
Putting on weight.
And the females, they need that energy to put forward towards producing those eggs.
Sure.
And so they're really looking for larger prey items that time of year. So that's kind of what we found with that research.
And so Jason, are there any specific projects that the agency is involved with currently in regards to muskie management?
Well, we continue to monitor their populations closely. One specific project that's been done for the past 2 to 3 years with a graduate student was looking at summertime mortality as a result to angling. And so we were working with the university on looking at that. So that's been really interesting to work on, and the results are kind of still forthcoming.
Sure.
We also have an online muskie diary program. That's pretty cool. You know, anglers are able to report where they're fishing. Not too much information, of course. Muskie anglers are very secretive, but we do need to know where they're fishing, how often, you know, whether they're happy, how many they're catching, that kind of thing. Because traditionally it's very hard to get that information from our normal creel surveys, which usually run during the summer months.
Sure.
Most anglers kind of hang it up that time of year. So
give the muskie a break. Yeah.
Program really allows us to target those groups, and we've had a really nice collaboration with Muskie's Inc. Chapter 76, which people might be interested in looking into. They've collaborated with us on a number of projects, and they've been really helpful with the diary program. So anglers should check that out and help us learn more about these fisheries.
And for anglers to learn more about the diary program and Muskie in general, where should they go to look?
We have an awesome Muskie page on the website. If you just Google DWR and then Muskellunge, it'll pop right up and you can go right to it. There's a Muskie 101 how-to video that we shot there. It has a listing of all the different resources that we stock, lots of cool background information, a link for the Muskie Diary program.
Basically everything you need to know there.
It really is, yeah. It's a one-stop shop, especially if you're new and want to get into Muskie fishing, that's where you want to go.
Awesome, thanks.
So let's tell them how we did today.
Yeah, so we got skunked. We didn't land any muskie today. And you know what? That's okay. That's part of muskie fishing. They don't call them the fish.
No, our schedules worked out so we could all get together. We could float the river today. So it was a good day. The sun was a little bit high in the sky.
Yeah.
Water conditions were really clear. We made a lot of cast.
Casts over casts over casts. They don't call them the fish of 1,000 casts for nothing. And we gave it a hard effort. I threw the fly rod for a while today. I was throwing a heavy 9-weight with a very short, about 18 inches of 80-pound fluorocarbon. And I was throwing some large flies in the kind of 10 to 12-inch range, really trying to stick it out. Towards the end of the day, I gave up and gave my arm a little bit of a break and started throwing some of the conventional setups. But John, you fished with a variety of different approaches today.
Yeah, I used a crankbait on the conventional rod with some braid.
And a couple different color setups. I know that was kind of the fire tiger that we went with at the end, but I remember you were throwing black for a little while, some of the inline spinners too.
Yeah, we switched it up a little bit, but just couldn't get a strike today.
Yeah, and you know, it was a couple times the fly would come out of a shadow and there'd be like a crevice of a rock, and I could have sworn, you know, your eyes start playing tricks on you after a little while. You keep thinking you're going to see a muskie. But I'm not giving up. This is my first time ever fishing for muskie. I think it would have been complete beginner's luck had I come out and gotten successful on the first go around. But we're going to get back out here. We're going to keep it
definitely.
Going. We're going to try to figure out how we can catch our first muskie. I definitely kind of have the muskie fever right now.
Definitely. And we encourage you to go out and try it for yourself.
Absolutely. So consider giving muskie a shot this winter. It's a great cold water species that allows you to kind of extend your fishing season. Don't hang up that rod and reel. There's awesome opportunities this winter. We'll see you on the water.